Starship updates and Boeing Starliner investigation complete. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. And let's dive right in fits this episode very well. Again, after just a few days, there has been so much change, development and progress again in Boca Chica that SpaceX is giving me a hard time sifting through all of it to give you a summary version of what's happening at the busiest space development site on the planet. Let's start with a massive shout out to RGV Aerial Photography again. Mauricio has done it again, and thanks to support from many who followed my call to join his Patreon, he's now able to do 3 flights per month. So expect a lot more footage from him and his slowly growing crew in the future thanks to, well, you. One community united, love it, you rock. RGV is doing an awesome job capturing pictures that make it a lot easier to understand how it all connects. The bird's eye view is priceless. The first thing to pop out here immediately is the new high bay construction. Tons of parts are on site and Bluezilla in the middle is ready for work. But this wouldn't be SpaceX if these pictures were not already outdated. Only one day later, the site looked like this. Maria Pointer was on site again taking this video of the very beginnings of construction for the tallest building in Boca Chica yet. At the rate at which SpaceX is going forward though, it won't take long at all. I said 4 weeks a week ago and it really does look like that at least the walls will be up by then, maybe even more. It's a joy to see the team on site work like this. Everyone follows a precise plan. If we take another look at Mauricio's footage, there's another side of interest and yet again another perfect example of how bird's eye views sometimes give the superior viewpoint. Just north of the high bay, there's a new development. Yet another patch of land is being prepared for build activity. Workers have already started filling and grading the site. It's unknown right now what SpaceX is building there, but if you look around, one thing becomes apparent quickly. More storage space would be a great thing to have. So it might just be a storage building, but even that would be yet another step towards an even more professional site. On we go with another indicator for SpaceX changing course yet again. Do you see the large steel rolls here? These are 39 rolls of stainless steel. More than enough to build a complete Starship. If you look here though, which is the ring manufacturing building used to make all the ring segments for Starship construction, you can quickly see that the building is at minimum activity right now. Musk announced a while ago that SpaceX in Boca Chica will switch from 301 stainless to 304L, which is a low carbon variant of stainless steel, making welding easier, corrosion even less of a problem, and material strength at cryogenic temperatures even better than with 301. Remember how the last test tank only leaked and didn't burst? My guess is that these newly delivered rolls of steel are the new 304 stainless, which will be used to produce future Starship prototypes from now on. So if I'm right, expect ring production to go up quite a bit in the coming weeks again. On we go with the launch site, where Starship serial number 5 is still waiting for a static fire. Everything is set after last week's cryo-proof test and SpaceX has announced new test dates. Every day from today until next week's Wednesday, 8 AM to 5 PM. And SpaceX has also announced again what the dates are to be used for. Today with backups tomorrow and Sunday are for static fire activity, Monday through Wednesday are for a 150-meter hop. Now, don't get your hopes up just yet. We've seen this a few times and problems during preparation have always prevented us from getting the first flight with a Starship tank stack, but it yet again shows that if everything goes right this time, we should have our first 150-meter hop by next week. We're not done yet with the landing site though. As predicted on a recent episode, SpaceX is starting to close the gap between the old test stand and the new Super Heavy launch support structure on the other side. Terrain grading has continued over the last few days all around the landing pad and the second layer is being put on top already. This connects the two until now separate sites and turns the launch site into one large complex of structures. I'm still keen to see if SpaceX will also rework the fuel farm in the process, but this will likely, if ever, happen after the 150-meter hop. One indicator for the fuel farm getting a rework soon is the recently set up new flare stack location. It really does look temporary, if you ask me. SpaceX needed the flare back and just put it there quickly. Nothing to stay for long. Since Musk already said that SpaceX wants to use large condensers to reuse methane and get rid of the flare stack altogether, I wouldn't be surprised if it's gone as soon as the 150 meter hop has happened. It's not official though, so we'll have to wait and see. Last but not least, let's have another look at the new Super Heavy launch pad, which is under construction right now. Now that drilling seems to be done, we can make out more details. The three holes drilled down and later filled up with large pillars of rebar reinforced concrete are set up in a triangular shape. Excavators have begun digging out a circular trench between them and there are pins sticking out in the middle. I'm not sure if these are just sticks to mark positions or permanent structure, but it indicates that there is going to be structure in the middle as well. If we look at the design of the launch mount that we saw on the animation released by SpaceX last year, the only structure here to need the three concrete pillars as foundation would be the large stacking and access crane. I'm not sure yet where SpaceX will point the flame diverter. It surely can't be towards the road. Maybe towards the landing pad? There are tons of pods next to the construction site as well. More rebar, large bent tubes, and all sorts of other stuff, so expect this construction to go up fast as well. Last but not least, I want to give a shout out to iCANimation and Space Intelligence. Carlos has done an absolutely awesome job lately of capturing SpaceX's work in Boca Chica from the viewing angle of an artist. These pictures are stunning. Great job, go check them out on Twitter, link is in the description. And if you want to get more info about SpaceX's Starship development, details about what exactly they're doing, and lots of other interesting insights into Blue Origin, NASA, Rocket Lab, and many other launch providers and their rockets, I suggest you check out my quickly growing library of episodes. While you're at it, do not forget to hit the like button wherever you see it, and please do subscribe if you have not done so yet. This shows the YouTube algorithm that you actually appreciate my work and in return enables me to make more content for you. Thank you! We're now about halfway through the year. 2020 has been a very strange one so far, but SpaceX seems to not take notice at all. Their progress is going strong as always, and we're off for a few more major milestones within the next few months. Boeing Starliner, the verdict. The second topic for today goes to SpaceX's biggest competitor when it comes to human spaceflight. The investigation by NASA regarding Boeing's crew capsule Starliner are over. But what did they find? Let's dive right in. It was December 20th of last year. A Boeing Starliner capsule was sitting on top of a ULA Atlas V rocket at Cape Canaveral Space Launch Complex 41 in Florida. The rocket launched with a picture-perfect launch done by ULA, and the Starliner failed to reach its intended orbit, circled the planet for 2 days, and landed safely back in New Mexico 2 days later. NASA has now finished its so-called high-visibility close call, and this finally gives us the whole picture and what needs to be done for a second orbital flight test later this year, which still needs a firm launch date. There were three main problems with Starliner that could have possibly even led to the loss of the capsule had the ground control team not intervened. The mission elapsed timer, an internal clock on board the capsule giving onboard computers information on where in the mission timeline the capsule is at any given time, malfunctioned. It interpreted a time information given by the Atlas V rocket 11 hours before the launch incorrectly, and so Starliner was never able to tell the correct timeline even right after the launch. Secondly, there was a software issue in Starliner's onboard systems that would have possibly caused the capsule to crash into the service module after separation. And last but not least, the Starliner capsule experienced a communication link issue, which prevented the ground crew from sending commands to the capsule in flight. Those are only the serious problems, though, that could have caused a catastrophic loss of the vehicle. NASA investigators presented Boeing with a list of 80 final recommendations after finishing their checks on July 7th. The list includes recommendations to software changes, hardware improvements, and to processes and operational improvements involving the way how Boeing's personnel has to work from now on. And Boeing seems to take it very seriously. Work has already started to implement every single recommendation on NASA's list, and Boeing seems to even go beyond. On June 21st, for example, Boeing conducted a so-called balloon drop test with a boilerplate Starliner capsule as part of a supplemental reliability campaign focusing on the parachute design to further validate the system's capabilities. Wow, what a sentence! The high-altitude balloon drop conducted high above White Sands, New Mexico in the United States utilized a helium balloon to send the capsule up into the atmosphere. Once the test altitude was reached, the capsule separated from the balloon and started the parachute deployment sequence to test the behavior under dynamic abort conditions. 6 seconds into the flight, small parachutes were deployed to lift Starliner's forward heat shield away. 10 seconds later, the capsule's two drogue chutes were deployed. Then a fault was deliberately introduced into the system, preventing one of Starliner's three main chutes to deploy. At 98 seconds into the test, only two of the three pilot chutes were fired, resulting in only two of the main chutes deploying. Despite higher loads, Starliner's parachutes seemed to handle the situation just fine, and the test resulted in a successful landing. Boeing is determined to not let anything go wrong again on the second orbital flight test to be conducted later this year. NASA's Commercial Crew program needs a second team to succeed, and there right now is no alternative to Boeing. Human spaceflight is the crown of any spaceflight activity. To achieve this goal, a strict plan has to be in place and innovative ways have to be found. The same goes for achieving your own goals in life. If you have the right plan and an innovative method, reaching set goals will be much easier for you. Many people are on the lookout for online math and science resources right now, and whether you're a student looking to get ahead, a professional brushing up on cutting-edge topics, or someone who just wants to use his time to understand the world better, you should check out Brilliant. Try adding some learning structure to your day by setting a goal to improve yourself and then work at that goal just a little bit every day. Brilliant makes that possible with interactive exploration and a mobile app that you can take with you wherever you are. If you're naturally curious, want to build your problem-solving skills, or need to develop confidence in your analytical abilities, then get Brilliant Premium to learn something new. Brilliant's thought-provoking math, science, and computer science content helps guide you to mastery by taking complex concepts and breaking them up into bite-sized understandable chunks. You'll start by having fun with their interactive explorations. Over time, you'll be amazed at what you can accomplish. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Learn new things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Bill Colbert, TJ Stamp, Seabass Branch, Poxy Clips, and Ryan J. Hermes. Thank you so much for your support. You rock. As always, I also want to thank my team for giving me priceless support with almost every aspect of the show. Without you guys, all this would never be possible. You rock. And if you're interested in becoming a community member or even a team member, go check out my Patreon or become a YouTube member to get access to the most awesome community in the world on our Discord. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It? Do you have any idea into which direction the flame diverter in Boca Chica will point? And are you as confident as Boeing about the Starliner's second try to reach the ISS? As always, tell me in the comments. Stainless, which will be used to...
Did you freaking see that? What was that? What the f... I'm scared.
Link is in the description. Channel promo.
What?
NASA has now finished its so-called hi-yi-yi on June 21st for...
Birth... Hey, fly.
To test the behavior and understand dynamic abort...